Now, how is this done? I want to describe the process, at least as I know it, so that we can understand even the people involved and how. There are two issues. One, either breakage into a pipeline, or two, just removing a valve or the head, well head, of a legally operated head that most times has been abandoned. Let me go to the second one, the abandoned wellhead. What happened, especially last year, was that in the process of divestment of the oil business, to especially by SPDC, to other players, there were challenges with the operation. And all the oil wells were not up. Maybe many of the oil wells were not operating at the time. Nothing was going on. So they just capped the wells. And of course, what did these thieves do? They would just go, just remove the valve. That was very easy. Remove the valve. Put your pipe, and you start sucking oil from there. That was very easy. But the other one, which before this one, was the issue of breakage of pipeline. Historically, breaking into the pipeline initially was very crude. They would go, maybe use an axe to break into the pipeline, take fuel, and leave the pipe running, spilling fuel all over the place. But I tell you that as of today, they have become more technical. More technical in the sense that skillfully, they insert their own valve. And when they are ready to remove the fuel, they just go, remove the fuel, remove the valve, put their pipe. And these pipes can run kilometers and kilometers. It's not maybe from here to here. Because sometimes the vessel will be in the high sea, and the pipe where they are pumping the fuel from, it's many kilometers away, but they have the pipe has enough length to go from the site where they are pumping it from to the high sea. And the technology of breaking into that pipeline is not known by the local community boys or the local persons. Neither is it known by me or any layman. It requires somebody who knows to be able to deal with that. I'm emphasizing that because this whole business is about collaboration. And who can have the knowledge of skillfully opening a pipeline or breaking into a pipeline? It must be somebody who has been doing it legally before and has now been recruited to do it illegally. And who was doing it legally before? Somebody who was working in the oil industry, either directly with the IOC or as a contractor. If you see some of the pictures of what is happening in the Niger Delta, in terms of pipeline breakage, you'll be amazed. In fact, there was one in which a house was built over the pipeline. The breakage was right in the middle of the house. The pipe came under the house. So you wouldn't know, it was buried from that point, and it came out. So when you are passing, you just see a house there. But that was a source of piping of fuel. Now, the pipe that is being used, like I said, may go kilometers into the high sea. Sometimes they just remove the fuel. The pipe might not be that long. So So they pipe into a very close vessel, which may be a barge or a wooden boat, what they call the Cotonou boat, a wooden boat. And that barge moves closer to the sea, empty into a bigger vessel, and that bigger vessel empties into the big, now moves direct to the sea and empties into the big sea, into the big ship in the big sea. Critical questions. One, how long does it take to break into the pipeline? And how long does it take to pipe this fuel? It's not something that is done in minutes, in hours. It takes days. If it takes days, why would somebody not stop them? Because right all over the Niger Delta, we have the security agencies. Why is somebody not able to stop them? Number one. Number two, if these things are carried with vessels, even from the shallow waters, using the Cotonou boats or the barges, and there are security patrols, why are they able to still go away with this crude? Somebody is supposed to be responsible for securing the waterways. But what is happening is that there's failure in that security arrangement. And so this crude is successfully stolen. What is done with the crude that is stolen? Two things. Some of it is used locally for local refineries. And which are these local refineries? Small refineries, very small. What are also called crude refineries. So what do? They just get drum. All you need is drums, maybe two or three drums, a pipe, small metal pipe, then fire under the drums. You put your crude, put your fire, you fire it, and of course the pipe distills the steam that is coming out of it, and it comes out as refined product. Might not be as refined as the real refinery, but it's a refined product that is used in many places. Because sometimes you see tankers lined up to take these products, and it's brought back to us as subsidized fuel. So, by estimation, maybe about 15 to 20% of that, of the fuel, is used for those local refineries. But most of the stolen crude goes outside the shores of Nigeria to service refineries that is not too far from Nigeria, and some go to the international market. So two things, like I said, that the stolen crude is used for. One, for local refineries. Two, they go into the international market as stolen fuel that is sold internationally. We need to find a way of ensuring that there's an improvement in the economic activities at the community level. And so this is a challenge, especially for the governments at the federal, the state, and local government council levels. States have devised ways of ensuring that some of the funds that is coming in goes to the communities and it's used for the development of the communities. So a lot of, there has to be stepping up of a lot of economic activities at the local level, so that at least the pool of people, especially the young ones, if they are busy, if they are doing one thing or the other, the pool that is left to be recruited for this criminal activity will be very much reduced. So the government itself has that responsibility of improving on the development and economic activities at the community level. Two, the security agencies. There's no doubt that there is some, please underline some, that there's some, we have some issues in the security in that area. This we have brought up to the security chiefs. I believe that something is being done. Because sometimes when people stay too long in a particular posting, there's temptation of getting absorbed. In terms of securing the Niger Delta, states have differences. Because you see, in Delta, for instance, we have three outlets into the high sea. So Delta, for you to leave the inland waterways of Delta to get to the high sea, it's a little bit easier to manage, because all you just do is to put security posts. It's like the roadblocks you have. You put security posts in those three points. Actually, the routes they go out with are mainly two. But you put, if you put security posts in those three points, and for any vessel that is passing, of course, the security agencies, whoever is behind that security point, should know. But in a place like Bayelsa, you have as many as 35 outlets. So if we really want to successfully secure Bayelsa, for instance, we need to man those 35 outlets. But like I said, even though some of these things are there, we still have leakages because of the collaboration. We believe that the IOCs have to look inwards. And I'm happy that some of them are doing that, but they really have to do more in terms of looking inwards to be able to deal with the issue of collaboration, internal collaboration and sabotage. I wouldn't want to dwell too much on that. But again, importantly for the IOCs, is your relationship with the communities. We have some IOCs that are relating very well for the community with the communities. Some just have nonchalant attitude about it. And I'm happy that the MD of Chevron is here. And I always say it, that if many IOCs can do what Chevron is doing, then the incidence of crude oil theft from their pipeline will be very much reduced. It's not as if it will not be there, but it will be very much reduced. And what have they done? They have what they call the regional development councils that sign agreement, sign MOU with the communities. And because they sign MOU with the communities have a sense of belonging and a sense of participation in the activities. And once they have a sense of participation, it's difficult for them to get involved in the stealing of the crude. A memorandum of understanding with the communities, in which communities now have a sense of belonging, and part of that sense of belonging is sense of protection of the pipelines. But even then, once in a while, we still have breakage into their pipelines. But it helps a lot, and I would recommend it for many IOCs. And then, having said that, the international collaboration, there's a lot of international collaboration. Like I said, over 80% of the stolen crude is sold outside. And so we require cooperation from the international communities, because this fuel is sold in certain countries, is sold in certain places. And so if the international body comes together and really say they want to assist in tracking this fuel, I believe that it will work. So we require some international collaboration. A lot of suggestions have been made, tag the fuel and all that. But whatever method, we require international collaboration. On the other side too, international collaboration in reducing the small arms that come in that help in the stealing of this crude. Because most of the arms that are used are not made in Nigeria. They are made outside Nigeria. They find their way into Nigeria and they come from somewhere. And I believe that some international bodies can help us trace where these arms come from and be able to deal with it. Now, we all know that, I think it was in January or so, that an approval was given. You cannot get license for bunkering. Why I didn't want to go to the issue of bunkering? Now, when you use the word bunkering itself, it's not illegal. It becomes only legal when you break into pipeline, take the fuel, and run away with it. But when you have a license and you go to a company that is allowed to give you XYZ amount of fuel and you ship it out, I think that is just the basic meaning of bunkering. It's not illegal. So one of the things, one of the ways I believe that we can help to reduce this issue is this license that is being given, instead of stealing the fuel, go and get the official license and it will reduce illegal bunkering. Then two, we have a lot of small refineries. Now the way the refineries are, the security people scatter these refineries, but it doesn't take more than 2 days to put up that kind of refinery. You just get drunk, pipeline, fire and all that. Within 2 days, they are back. So as you are destroying maybe five, because sometimes you hear that, oh, five have been destroyed. But the truth is, where those five are destroyed, 15 spring up the next day. So it's been a big challenge. And some people are now saying, can we not improve on the technology of those refineries and have small refineries where we can put 3-4 youths together that can own a small refinery, we call modular refinery, and with time they grow. That is arguments by some people, whether it is correct or not, but we believe that that is one thing that, so at least they get crude legally, they refine their products, and they sell their products. But finally, in all of this, what our committee believe is very critical and important is prosecution. Until we start to take prosecution very seriously, we believe that this business might continue to go on. Our laws today, what has been happening is, when people are arrested by these security agencies, they took them to courts that do not have the jurisdiction to even prosecute these people. So what happens? They are released. That is one. Two, who are those that have even been arrested? I call them the jerry can illegal bunkers. What is jerry? People who steal fuel with jerry can. I'm sure when you look at the television, those are the ones you see that are arrested, Abby. The ones with jerry can. The big players are not arrested. We must have the political will to identify the big players and get them prosecuted. I underline political will, and that political will is not me alone. Many of you now know, I don't want to say too much. But everybody that is involved in this business has to have political will to really get the key players and get them, by the time we start prosecuting, serious prosecution, then we might be talking about an end to illegal bunkering or crude oil thefts.